Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is Ash Wednesday. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Blow the trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. that all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming, it is near, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, like blackness spread upon the mountains. A great and powerful army comes. Their light has never been from of old, nor will be again after them in ages to come. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful. Slow in anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God? Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Sanctify the congregation, assemble the aged. Gather the children, even infants, at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room, and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the peoples, where is their God? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Wash me and I shall be purer than snow. troubled and broken heart, O God, you will not despise.
The second reading is from 2 Corinthians 5 and 6 chapters. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, at an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now in the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute, we are treated as imposters and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see, we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Next week's subject being the forsaken one. This evening, is the substitute. Next week, next Wednesday night, is the forsaken one, of course. Then after next week, each Wednesday will meet at 7 here in the sanctuary. Let us now sing What Wondrous Love Is This, hymn number 666, in the back of your worship book, hymn number 666.
Or we have an example of a good substitute.
generic drugs for the original drug. When you're able to switch to a generic, your cost of your prescription goes down dramatically. You have substitutes or substitutions in athletics, where a starter is taken out for a substitute. Now, if it's a real good team, there is very little difference between the starter and the substitute. But if it's a poorer team, then when the substitute comes in, there is a drop in athletic ability, and sometimes the opposing team can take advantage of that substitution. There is good substitutes in having a substitute teacher, or at least in my days in school it was, especially elementary school and junior high school. We looked forward to having a substitute teacher, because it meant most of the day we were going to play. It meant that we were going to have to show our homework, that we weren't going to have to discuss that passage we had to read that we did not comprehend. When I was in elementary school, we had one popular substitute teacher who was a veteran of World War II and a former deputy sheriff. And in the war, he had lost his arm from below his elbow and through his hand. So his arm just ended in kind of a pointed stump. And he would share with us stories how when he was a deputy sheriff, that stump had become so hard that when he was trying to subdue his subject, he didn't have to use his billy club or in order to subdue it. He just hit him with that stump of his hand or arm, and that would bring him under control real fast. So we would get him off track, get him talking about that. There was no math that day, no English, no history, but there was lunch and there was recess, and there was his story. So that was a good substitute. We also had substitutes such as, which are bad, when we see an advertisement for an item at a certain store, and we go to that store and they don't have that item. They're all out. But they'll gladly substitute this instead of that for a higher price. Or, if you remember the movie or saw the movie, the original Family Vacation with Chevy Chase, those, and listen, are all car dealers, and I've had car dealers in every congregation I've served, and they were good, and they were truthful, and they were upright, but you do have certain car dealers who will, you come to them and you say you want this certain model of car, well, they immediately realize they're not going to make that much commission on that car, so they try to steer you to a different model, to a higher price model. And going back to the movie Vacation, if you remember that, Chevy Chase's character had bought this car from his dealer to take on a family vacation, and he brings his car in, and they immediately take it and put it in the car crusher, so it's crushed, can't get it back. And they bring out this automobile that he didn't purchase. And the fellow tells him, oh, you're gonna like this better, you know, this is a better car and a better deal. And Chevy Chase wants what he bought, so then he says, well, bring my car back. And of course, they can't bring his car back. They've already crushed it into a little metal box. And so, unfortunately, because he has to go on vacation, he ends up having to buy the family truckster for more money than the original station wagon he wanted. That's a bad substitute. Tonight, we're going to talk about the greatest substitute of all. We're going to focus on the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ. In our sermon text from the 27th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, we come to Good Friday. Pontius Pilate has been trying to free Jesus to no avail. So now he comes to that part where he is going to offer them a choice. They can either free Barabbas, a criminal, a thug, a punk, a guy who had tried to lead a revolution against the Roman occupation of Judea, or they can free Jesus Christ. So when we read in the 26th verse of the 27th chapter of Matthew, we read, then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. That word translated as deliver. It means to yield up something. It means to surrender something to someone, to give someone over to another person. Or it means, and this is my favorite definition of it, because I think it describes really what Pontius Pilate did. It has the meaning of to betray. So Pontius Pilate betrayed Jesus. Pontius Pilate knew Jesus was innocent. His wife even sent him word that she had a dream about Jesus and that he was an innocent man and that Pontius Pilate should have nothing to do with him. But Pilate could not stand upon justice. He could not enforce justice or the law, and instead betrays Jesus by allowing him to be handed over to be crucified. So the crowd chose Barabbas. Now the name Barabbas is not an actual name. It means son of Rabbis. Very like Simon Bar-Jonah. When you talk about Peter, Simon, son of Jonah. That's the way people were named in Judaism in the days of Jesus. So many scholars believe that Barabbas' first name was the same as Jesus. So in Greek, it would be Jesus Barabbas, Jesus son of Barabbas, versus Jesus the Christ, the anointed, the Son of God. In Hebrew, it would be Yeshua Barabbas, Yeshua son of Barabbas, and it would be Yeshua Bar Adonai, or Yeshua Bar El, or Elohim, Yeshua son of the Lord, or Yeshua, son of God. They wouldn't say Yeshua bar Yahweh because they would not pronounce God's proper name. So here they have a choice between the secular and the spiritual, heaven and the earthly. And so they choose Barabbas. And Christ dies as a substitute for Barabbas. For legally, it was Barabbas who should have been on that third cross. As the carpenters were making the three crosses that day, that one of those crosses had Barabbas' name on it. But because of the crowd, Jesus becomes Barabbas' substitute. And it is Jesus who dies. Pilate gave them a choice. And so often, like today, the crowd chose what satisfied their wants and what they think were their needs. They chose what satisfied their ambitions instead of thinking about their souls or thinking about eternity. The crowd wanted a warrior. That was a vision of the Messiah they had mistakenly been taught. Ignoring the prophets who talked about the Messiah as a suffering servant, as one who would be led to his death like a lamb to the slaughter. Instead, they wanted someone like David, who would reestablish the glory of ancient Israel. That would make Judea, the Roman province of Judea, the country of Judah again, and the pearl of the Mediterranean. So they were not thinking spiritually, only secularly. And so often today, people do the same. Barabbas, of course, is an example of all sinners which are completely guilty. Whereas Jesus is completely innocent. Jesus is holy, and Jesus is just. Christ, therefore, ends up being the substitute for us all. Not just for Barabbas, but for every human being. From the time of his death upon that cross until he returns in glory. The crowd cries for Christ to die. In 2020 hindsight, we look at the actions of the crowd and we cannot believe their stupidity. With 2020 hindsight, we look at the crowd and we see their actions as being abhorrent. With 2020 hindsight, we look back at the crowd and we see their actions as being totally unreasonable and out of the mind. And we would like to say self-righteously that if we were there, we would have screamed for Jesus to be free. But unfortunately, like the crowd that day, we too are sinners. And we too often in such a situation would go with what we want, what we need, what we dream, what our ambitions are, and not what God is doing. It's similar to Christmas. We read about there being no room in the inn for Mary and Joseph and the soon-to-be-born baby Jesus. And we say, oh, if we'd been back there in Bethlehem, we would have opened our home to Jesus, to Mary and Joseph, even if it meant making our kids all double up in one room and giving them their room, we would have done it. But as Martin Luther says in a famous Christmas sermon, oh, we say we would welcome Mary and Joseph and Jesus into our home, but we wouldn't have. We would have been just like every other resident of Bethlehem, because we are a sinner, just like they were. It doesn't matter how much power we have, it doesn't matter how much influence we have, it doesn't matter how much smarts we have, money we have, material things we have, we are all sinners and fall far short of the glory of God. Today, people still choose Barabbas over Jesus. You choose Barabbas over Jesus when you seek treasures on earth instead of the treasures of heaven. As Jesus said in our gospel reading, which I'm sure you recognize as part of the Sermon on the Mount, in our gospel lesson, Jesus said to not store up treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and thieves bring in and steal, but instead store up treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy and thieves cannot bring in and steal. And that where our treasure is, there is our heart also. So we choose Barabbas when we make the things of the world more important than our faith and our salvation. We choose Barabbas whenever we don't think about the afterlife, whenever we don't think about life after death, until we are on our deathbed. Maybe then it will be too late. If someone doesn't come to you before you breathe your last breath and share with you the good news of the gospel of salvation and faith in Jesus Christ, you leave this world without that faith in Christ, and there's no second chance. There's no other opportunity. And so we are Barabbas when we don't think about the afterlife and the world to come. We choose Barabbas whenever we seek the pleasures of the flesh over holiness and justification in Jesus Christ. And we choose Barabbas over Jesus whenever we ignore God's will to follow our own pleasure. As many of you heard on Sunday, I first felt the call to be a parish pastor, or to be a pastor in the third grade. And that feeling of call I kept through all the way through elementary school, junior high school, into college until my junior year. The call was still there, and I could still feel it. But I decided for some ignorant reason, my junior year, that I was going to turn my back on that call. And I was going to do what John wanted to do. And that was to go into teaching and be a coach. And if coaching proved successful, to hopefully move from coaching high school to college, probably start. starting out in Division 1, or Division 2 or 3, and hopefully moving up to Division 1. And depending how good I was, maybe eventually ending up in professionals. And so I turned my back on my religious studies and began to study nothing but secular subjects and more history, and I looked toward receiving a teaching degree. And that junior year in college, I have told people, was like Jonah in the belly of the whale. And it wasn't until I repented and returned to my church-related college, my senior year, that I felt that relief and felt once again that I was indeed on the path that God was calling. But we choose Barabbas when we hear God call us and we turn our back on that call, no matter what age we are, and no matter what it is that God is calling us to do. He may not be calling us to go to seminary at 75 years old, like some people have had happen to them. He may not call you to be a missionary at 60 years old, but he may call you or will call you to do something within your congregation. Something to do within your circle of friends in regards to witnessing to faith in Jesus Christ. But then comes the good news. The death of Christ brings to us release. The word released, when it says that Pilate had Barabbas released, and Jesus delivered to be scourged and crucified. That word release means to be set free. It means to give liberty to captives. It means to free fully without any chance of harm again. Give liberty to the captives reminds us of the Hebrew children in bondage in Egypt. It reminds us how through Moses God delivered those Hebrew children and liberated the captives. Feel free, or be free fully, is what happened to Barabbas. Even though the Romans knew what a thug he was, even though they knew what a criminal he was, even though they knew that he was a rebellious anti-Roman person, they could not rearrest him. They could not, way back then, they could not practice double jeopardy. Barabbas was now free until he committed a new crime. As I say, it's like our double jeopardy. When you are acquitted of a crime, even though you did it, and later they find proof that you did it, you cannot be tried again for that crime. Back in the 90s, I believe it was, because I'm pretty sure we'd move from Florence to Griffith when this happened. But in my hometown of Louisville, a wife was murdered. And most of the evidence pretty much led or pointed to the husband. And almost everybody in the city believed the husband did it. But he came to trial. And unfortunately, the prosecution just didn't have that overwhelming piece of evidence to convince everybody. And so the defense attorney was able to sow enough doubt in enough jurors' minds that he was acquitted. He could not be tried for his wife's murder again. A year later, a young couple bought the house where the murder had taken place. And they decided to replace all the carpeting throughout the house. And they came into one room and they noticed that in one corner where the rug corner piece should have been tacked down, it was kind of curling up. And so they just pulled on it and the rug came up easily. And they pulled it back so far until they noticed two boards in the floor that were kind of uneven. And they took a screwdriver and they popped them up, and underneath was a video. Back in the day before DVDs, when everybody still had VCRs. So they took the videotape and they stuck it into their TV. And after 5 minutes, they turn it off and call the police. The police came to the house and watched the video. And what was on that video was a sickening ire of that husband torturing his wife before, after an hour of torture, he killed her. Now, there was absolute proof that he did the murder, but because of double jeopardy, he could not be tried for his murder. Of course, the city was outraged, but there was nothing they could do. Until finally, a federal prosecutor stepped in and charged him with violating his wife's civil rights. At least that was something. But it only put the man in prison for about 5 to 7 years, not life without parole or the death house. See, he was fully free. That's what Jesus does for us with his death upon the cross. He makes us fully free so that no matter how much the devil stomps and whines and pitches a fit and carries on to Jesus about all that we've done, his words fall on deaf ears because we are cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Cleansed by that blood shed that first Good Friday upon that horrible cross that was meant for Barabbas, but because Jesus was the substitute, we have eternal life. We have the forgiveness of sin. We have victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. We are fully free. The devil can never do double jeopardy on us. All believers are freed from that captivity to sin, death, and the devil. Like Barabbas, we deserve to die for our sins. But Jesus, death on the cross, brings us redemption. A famous singer made an album cover on which was pictured two dogs. One was black with a white stripe. The other one was white with a black stripe. The black dog was named Sin, and the white dog was named Redemption. And the singer said that even when he was bad, he had a little good in him. Like the black dog, that little stripe of white showed him there was a little bit of good. He said, but now that he tries to be good, he still isn't perfect. He still sins, and so that's why the black stripe on the white dog. Well, it wasn't painted, these all knew it was just their natural way they were, but that is what they showed. And that is the human life. We're not all bad, and we're not all good, but we need to save. We need a substitute. We need Jesus. The death of Jesus gives us that redemption, gives us that pass to heaven, gives us that gift of everlasting life, freeing us from sin, death, and the devil, so that we do not have to try and earn it ourselves and fail miserably. Substitutes in life may not always be what we want. Substitutions in life may bring us disappointment. But when it comes to salvation, Jesus Christ is the substitute that saves the world. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us now sing, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed, hymn number 337, in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 337. Please turn to page 252 and 253 in the front of your worship book. Friends in Christ, today with the whole church we enter the time of remembering Jesus' Passover from death to life, and our life in Christ is renewed. We begin this holy season by acknowledging our need for repentance and for God's mercy. We are created to experience joy in communion with God, to love one another, and to live in harmony with creation. But our sinful rebellion separates us from God, our neighbors, and creation, so that we do not enjoy the life our Creator intended. As disciples of Jesus, we are called to a discipline that contends against evil and resists whatever leads us away from love of God and neighbor. I invite you, therefore, to the discipline of living, self-examination and repentance, prayer and fasting, sacrificial giving and works of love, strengthened by the gifts of word and sacrament. Let us continue our journey through these 40 days to the great 3 days of Jesus' death and resurrection. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most holy and merciful God, we confess to you and to one another and before the whole company of heaven that we have sinned by our fault, by our own fault, by our own most grievous fault, and thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We have not forgiven others as we have been forgiven.
Have mercy on us, O God.
We have shut our ears to your call to serve as Christ served us. We have not been true to the mind of Christ. We have grieved your Holy Spirit.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our past unfaithfulness, the pride, envy, hypocrisy, and apathy that have infected our lives, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our self-indulgent appetites and ways, and our exploitation of other people, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our negligence in prayer and worship, and our failure to share the faith that is in us, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our neglect of human need and suffering, and our indifference to injustice and cruelty, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our false judgments, our uncharitable thoughts towards our neighbors, and our prejudice and contempt towards those who differ from us, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Our waste and pollution of your creation, and our lack of concern for those who come after us, we confess to you.
Have mercy on us, O God.
Restore us, O God, and let your anger depart from us. Hear us, O God,
for your mercy is great.
Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. May these ashes be a sign of our mortality and penitence, reminding us that only by the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ are we given eternal life. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We also would like to receive the imposition of ashes. You may now come forward. Please turn to page 254. Accomplish in us, O God, the work of your salvation. By the cross and passion of your Son, our Savior,
bring us with all your saints the joy of his resurrection.
Almighty God, have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us in our goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Please stand.
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care, and prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. St. John practices an open communion. For all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, we believe his body and blood are truly present as we gather at his table, in our community age, in your own individual congregation, we are invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152 in the front of your worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks.
Thanks and praise to Almighty and merciful God, to our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse our hearts and prepare a joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, the church on earth, and hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their remaining hymn.
Thank you.
given for you, the body of Christ 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 given for you. Those who came to this day. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen, preserve you in true faith and the life eternal.
Amen.
Let us pray. Merciful God, accompany our journey through these 40 days. Renew us in the gift of baptism that we may provide for those who are poor, pray for those in need, fast from self-indulgence, and above all that we may find our treasure in the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
If you conclude our observance with Just As I Am Without One, please, hymn number 592 in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 592.
Just as I am.
concludes our Ash Wednesday evening service. Join us Sunday at 8 o'clock and 10:30 for our regular Sunday service. And then next Wednesday, our Lenten series will start, and there will be a pre-Lenten supper from 5:30 to 6:45 before the 7 o'clock service. All are welcome.